Hello everyone, welcome to Teaching PATHSHALA. Today we are going to deal with introduction portion of developmental biology of Drosophila, and this is the part 1. This portion is one of the most important topic for CSIR NET examination. In every attempt you are going to see at least 1 to 2 questions from this part. Although the details of developmental biology of Drosophila will going to have many complex and you can say that many confused process because there is an involvement of lots of genes and proteins, but the thing is like if you understand the whole concept, then you have to pay your attention, you have to give some time on this topic, and after that you will see that this topic has become easier to you. And this is one of the most lengthiest part of developmental biology. So let's begin with the introductory portion of this video. So first of all, we are going to see some detail or the basic detail about the Drosophila. Commonly, we used to call it as a fruit fly, and this Drosophila melanogaster has been used in research in our genetics and is a very common model organism in our developmental biology. The males of this genus are known to have the longest sperm cells of any organism on the earth. So the Drosophila genus is going to have a longest sperm as compared to the other organisms which are there on earth. Drosophila melanogaster is a popular experimental animal because it is a very easy to culture in a mass because its generation time is very small and the overall life cycle is also I think of 21 days. So it is very easier to culture this organism in a lab and we can see the overall result in a very small duration of time. It has a short generation time and mutant animals are readily obtainable. That means if you create some kind of a mutation in the Drosophila, then you can very easily you can see the result in a short duration of time because they mainly used to take I think 7 to 8 days to grow in a adult Drosophila. The last line is Drosophila species are widely used in studies of genetics, embryogenesis and other areas. Now let's talk about the lifespan of Drosophila melanogaster. So the Drosophila melanogaster lifespan is about 21 days from egg to the death. So it takes total 21 days, that is from birth to the death. So overall, the lifespan is of a 21 days. The developmental period of Drosophila varies with temperature. The shortest developmental time, that is egg to adult, is of a 7 days and is achieved at 28 degrees Celsius. The overall development of a Drosophila is highly dependent on temperature. If it is going to get an optimum temperature, obviously it is going to show a good amount of a development in it. But it's like they have given a data that the shortest development time, that is from egg to the conversion to the adult, is of a 7 day. And this developmental like stage has been achieved on 28 degrees Celsius. So we can say that their developmental period are highly temperature specific or they are dependent on the temperature for their growth. The second point is the small size, short generation time and the large offspring size make it ideal for the genetics studies. Because in genetics, there is a lot of process which our scientists use to test on a particular model organism. Okay, and the main quality of a model organism is that it should be small in size, there should be a short generation time and the like short lifespan so that they could test any gene and they can get the result as soon as possible. And the next quality is that they should have a large offspring size so that in a short duration of a time, like we are going to get a lot of offsprings of our Drosophila and finally we can do a different test on that offsprings. And this Drosophila melanogaster was first introduced into the field of genetics experiment by Thompson Hunt Morgan. After this, the main question is that why Drosophila regarded as a model organism? Okay, so I have kept very few points and this is in a very easiest language. So let's go through it. One important feature of an animal model is that the ability to manipulate its genome and investigate the function of a specific gene. Okay, so this is the first property of a model organism that it should be easily manipulated. That means the genome of that organism which is served as a model organism, their genome should be easily manipulated and the investigation of the functional gene can be very easy to study on that organism. The second point is that they have been used for research at all level of biology, but genetic research is where these organisms really shine. So the main function for which the Drosophila was regarded as a model organism was the genetic research study. The third point, genetic manipulation are so much easier in fruit flies because they have a smaller genome. You know that if a genome is of a very large size, it is very tedious to handle that genome. Okay, because we have to deal with many factors if we are manipulating a particular genome. But due to the small size of genome, this Drosophila is going to have a plus point to be regarded as a model organism. The fourth point is that Their short life cycle and the large number of offsprings are also advantageous for genetic research because new fly lines are quick and easy to make. So this, I think there is nothing to explain in this line because we have already dealt with this. Fifth point is that making a new line of flies usually only takes about 6 weeks and it costs less. Due to the short life cycle, the new Drosophila lines will going to be ready in a 6 weeks. And the overall cost on maintenance of all this process is very low. The sixth point is an estimated 75% of known human disease genes have a match in the fruit fly genome. And this is one of the most important factor that is making Drosophila as a model organism. Because 75% of disease that used to cause in a human, the whole disease can be searched on a or can be like tested on a Drosophila. And it is going to give a like positive result because it seems like whatever the factor which is going to cause disease in human, the same factor is going to cause the same disease in a Drosophila too. So scientists can use this property in knock-in and knock-down of a different gene, and then they are going to see an expression in a Drosophila that what kind of a manipulation or what kind of a phenotypic effect they can see in a Drosophila. And with that, they are going to like conclude that what kind of effect it is going to show in a human. The last point is that they are already being used as a genetic model for several human diseases, including the Parkinson disease. Let's talk about one example regarding the Parkinson disease. So scientists know that the mutation in a PINK1 gene is responsible for the Parkinson disease in human. But initially, they don't know that what the gene actually does. So what they have did, the researcher need to know the gene's normal or the actual function before investigating that how the mutation lead to the Parkinson disease and how to treat that. So in animal model, researchers can study the gene's function by manipulating the relevant gene in the animal's genome. One important type of genetic modification is the gene knockout, which means they induce mutation in a specific gene so that it becomes inactive or non-functional. And at last, by observing the resulting changes in a physiological process or the behavior of an animal, researchers can determine that what role the gene played in a normal functioning. So in this example in which I have told you about the PINK1 gene, the scientists can knock out the PINK1 gene in fruit fly or mice, and then they will going to observe that what kind of a phenotypic changes they are going to show or what kind of a behavior changes they are going to show. So with this process, they are going to know that what is the normal functioning of a PINK1 gene. Because after the knockout, that function will going to be absent in a body of a particular fruit fly or a mouse. So in this way, they will come to know that what was the normal function of a PINK1 gene. And after that, they will going to study about the mutation cases that is going to lead to a Parkinson disease. Always remember one thing, that if you want to know the actual function of any kind of a new gene, first you have to knock out that gene from a particular organisms. Okay. And the absence of a particular function is going to give you a proof that might be that function was related to that knockout gene. So this is the initial step to know the functioning of a novel gene. This slide contains the additional information regarding the Drosophila. Might be it would be helpful for you all. So Drosophila display a holometabolous method of development, meaning that they have the distinctive stages of their post-embryonic life cycle. So they used to display a holometabolous development. And what is the meaning of a holometabolous? So holometabolous, also called the complete metamorphosis, and is a form of an insect development which include 4 life stages, that is egg, larva, pupa or imago, which is also known as an adult. That means the holometabolous will include the total 4 stages of life, that is the egg, then egg will going to convert into a larva, then larva will going to convert into a pupa, and then it will going to convert itself into an adult. So the overall this 4 step is going to call as a holometabolous development, which is also known as the complete metamorphosis. So here there is an introduction of a new word, that is metamorphosis. So metamorphosis is a biological process by which an animal physically develops after birth or hatching. So it is just a process of transformation. How the one stage has going to help in the transformation to some other stages. That is called the metamorphosis. In the diagram, you can see that there is a representation of a holometabolous development. That there is a presence of an egg. The egg has been converted into a larva. Larva has transformed into a pupa, and the pupa finally will going to develop into an adult fly. So it is an overall development process of a fly, which is also going to show a holometabolous. So same developmental pattern is going to shown by a Drosophila too. Till this point, we have studied about the basic concept of Drosophila, that what is the life cycle, why it is regarded as a model organism, what are the different type of way is there through which a Drosophila can be used in a research laboratory. Now, the main topic is the developmental biology of Drosophila, in which we are going to study about the different topic, that is the fertilization in Drosophila, then the axis formation, that is the anterior and the posterior side. Then we are going to study about the segment formation and the parasegment formation. Then this specifying the function of each segment. And then the last, we will going to study about the generation of a dorsal and the ventral polarity. So first of all, in the front of you, there is a figure in which you can see the overall side, that the mouth side is going to be called as an anterior. The back side or the tail side will be regarded as a posterior. The front side will be regarded as a ventral, and the back side is going to be regarded as a dorsal. So this polarity, you should remember that which is the dorsal side, which is the ventral side, which is the anterior, and which is the posterior. Because in the upcoming slide, I'm not going to give you a basic idea about this because I'm already discussing this in this video. So try to understand the basic of this, because in the upcoming video, we are going to enter into a detailed pathway of all this developmental process of Drosophila. Now the main point is that there is an involvement of total three groups of genes that used to play a very important role in the developmental process of Drosophila. And these three group of genes are very, very important, and you have to remember each and every genes that used to come in the category of all these three genes. So first is the maternal genes, which is regarded as they used to express in a mother's ovary. Okay, and that means they used to express before the formation of a zygote. The second category of gene is the zygotic genes, which is also known as a segmentation genes. And the subcategory of this zygotic genes is the gap genes, pair rule genes, and the segment polarity genes. So this zygotic genes used to express after the formation of a zygote, that means after the occurrence of a fertilization. The second category of gene is the homeotic selector genes, which is going to give the identity for each segment. When we are going to study about these three type of gene, there is a lot of concept of a morphogen and the morphogenic gradient. Okay, so your concept should be clear that what is morphogen, what is the function of a morphogen, what is the nature of a morphogen. So I have already uploaded a video on morphogen and the morphogenic gradient. So try to clear your concept regarding these two factors, that is what is morphogen and what is the morphogenic gradient. Because in the upcoming video, there is a lot of use of these two words, that is the morphogen and the morphogenic gradient, and we are going to see a different type of a morphogen while studying the developmental process of Drosophila. So try to clear your concept, because I'm not going to tell you about the basics regarding the morphogen and the gradient in the upcoming videos, because I have already uploaded a total single video on this topic. So try to clear your concept on this, and then we are going to start with the new topic. Let's see what are the different genes are there which used to fall under these three main category. So the first category was of the maternal genes, in which we are going to study about the bicoid, hunchback, nanos, and the caudal genes. Second is the gap genes, which is the subcategory of the zygotic genes. So it will include the cruple, crips, giant, hunchback, and the tailless. Third subcategory is the pair rule genes, which is again going to come under the zygotic genes. It will include the different genes like hairy, even skipped, runt, fushi terazu, odd skipped, slopy paired, and paired. The next subcategory is the segment polarity genes, which will include the different genes like wingless, cubitus interruptus, patched, ingrailed, hedgehog, and the armadillo. And the last category is of the homeotic genes, which will include the labile, antennapedia, sex com reduced, deformed, proboscipedia, ultrabithorax, abdominal A, and abdominal B. Sorry, it would be abdominal B, not abdominal A. First is the abdominal A, and second will be the abdominal B. So these are the group of genes about which we have to study. And I know this is very complex to remember, but once you started seeing the overall process, you can easily able to memorize all these genes. Although we don't have to study about the each and every genes, there are some important genes about which we will study, and that we are going to see in our next video. So if this video was helpful for you, then don't forget to hit the like button. You can share this video with your friends who are preparing for the CSINET examination. And if you are new to my channel, you can subscribe my channel for getting more different videos on CSINET, GATE, and different life science examination. And along with that, don't forget to hit the bell icon so that you will be notified with my each and every new video uploads. Thank you.